Hello everyone. Narcissist Free Almost here, and this week I'm going to talk about the dynamics of a narcissistic relationship, mainly from the narcissist perspective according to Otto Kernberg and object relations theory. To begin, what we already know is that, more often than not, the narcissistic personality enacts his or her own pathological grandiose self, while projecting a devalued part of the self onto the partner, whose unending admiration confirms the grandiose self. So here you might have the partner believing the narcissist's projections, that he or she is less than, while simultaneously adoring the prop up and very convincing grandiose self of the narcissist. Just to review, here is the personality structure of the narcissist. On the left side you have the grandiose part self kept apart from the inadequate, fragmented, unworthy and unentitled part self. And on the bottom left there is the omnipotent part object kept apart from the harsh, attacking and devaluing part object. That said, you can see where the narcissist's grandiose self is projecting the devalued part of himself onto the partner. What will happen far less often is when the narcissistic personality projects the pathological grandiose self onto the partner and then enacts a relationship between the grandiose self and its projected reflection. In essence, the narcissist is having a relationship with him or herself. So, let me repeat that, the narcissist projects the grandiose self onto the partner and then proceeds to have a relationship between the grandiose self and its reflections. Insane, right? And it is. When this is happening, the partner is then just a vehicle for a relationship between aspects of the narcissist's self. Now there is the idealized partner, and out there, in orbit is the partner as a satellite image to that ideal object that the couple then enacts in fantasy. Or, they form an unconscious reflection in which each partner replicates the other. Have you ever seen this? I have. It's that seemingly perfect couple, but the feeling you get is that something is off, and maybe they're trying too hard. It seems phony, or perhaps like they're hiding something. Also, they can, in complementing each other, jointly reconstitute a fantasied and lost grandiose ideal unit. Of central importance here is pre-Oedipally determined envy. That is, a specific form of rage and resentment against a needed object that is experienced as frustrating and withholding. Looking back on the pre-Oedipal stage, where attachment to the mother predominates for both sexes, there will be an unintegrated superego. That same superego that expanded rather than integrated, hijacked the narcissist's present functioning and turned it into the now, abnormal self structure. Recall the pre-Oedipal stage here, where you have the ego ideal, felt as persecutory because of its demands for perfection, and the persecutor part object, felt as punitive and retaliatory. As I've said before, in the narcissist, this pre-Oedipal superego was kept from integrating further due to the use of manic defenses, those defenses used to keep at bay feelings of ambivalence such as guilt, fear of loss, mourning, and pining and longing for an object. Essentially, what I'm trying to impress is that one is dealing with a superego that is stunted at 3 years of age or less. With that said, what is desired thus becomes a source of suffering as well. Put another way, to the narcissist what is loved inevitably becomes their suffering. Sounds like a paradox, doesn't it? Well, like most things I talk about here, it is and it isn't, and hopefully I can make sense of this for you. Because the narcissist's ego, superego, and self are in parts, they will be alternating between extremes, from the ultimate good and wonderful, to the unimaginably terrible and painful. There is no gray area, or rather a gray area that will not be allowed. Recall the affect that links the two part self and part objects. That linking effect is abandonment depression, hence the need to use every defense against acknowledging it, let alone feeling it. This is something they've been avoiding their entire life and, ironically, the one thing that would allow their integration. If you'd like more information on this, please see the videos I did on James Masterson, on the Masterson approach to borderline and narcissistic personality disorders. But for now we're back to love betrayed, or that frustration felt in infancy that can never be satisfied. The narcissist, as I've just explained, cannot love someone without experiencing corresponding suffering. Again, everything experienced will be in polar opposites. When they suffer, their reaction is a conscious and unconscious wish to destroy, to spoil, to appropriate by force what is being withheld, specifically, what is most admired and wished for. Keep in mind this is purely the narcissist's perception of what is being withheld, and perception is not reality, and we all know by now that the narcissist's relation to reality is tenuous at best. But, the real tragedy of the narcissist is that angry appropriation, and greedy extraction of what is denied and envied, do not lead to satisfaction, because the unconscious hatred of what is needed spoils what is incorporated. The subject always ends up feeling empty and frustrated. Enough is never enough. And here's more irony for you: no matter how much goodness the other has to offer, that goodness is a source of envy for the narcissist. And what do when they envy something? Destroy, spoil, or take by force. Now, keep in mind here, I'm talking about a narcissist attempting to be in a relationship. So, of course they gravitate to what they want to have for themselves, and that will always come from a place of envy. But there's also dependency of some kind in a relationship, right? And for the narcissist this is impossible. Recall that narcissists abhor dependency on another, and this, again, goes back to the use of manic defenses in infancy and early childhood. This denial of dependency is where control is born. If I can control you, then I don't depend on you. But the caveat is while controlling you I'm, in the most devious way, compelling you to take care of my dependency needs. And this is why narcissists are so expertly controlling, and why dependency for a loved object is impossible. Moreover, the narcissistic personality needs to be admired rather than loved, and who hasn't found this out the hard way, right? The truly pathological narcissist doesn't give a rip about love for the reasons I've already laid out. In fact, they don't believe in love per se. To them, relationships are simply transactional, period. But, of course, they're not going to let you in on that little secret because, if they did, you would hardly, willingly, participate. Furthermore, to regulate their self-esteem they ultimately need the admiration of the other. This supports and reconfirms their self-esteem, and the self-idealization of the pathological grandiose self. The admiration of others replaces the normally protective and self-esteem regulating functions of the weakened and distorted superego, and in particular, the ego ideal. To sum things up, we have the pathological narcissist relating to the world through an abnormal self-structure. To regulate their fragile self-esteem, they require admiration in any form they can extract it from another, even if it means projecting their own grandiose self onto the other, and having a relationship with that projected grandiose self. What a magic trick, huh? Mostly using infantile defenses, and later strengthened in adulthood, love isn't a concept they could possibly understand because this requires mature, higher-order emotions. Instead, they rely solely on external validation to constantly balance their fragile and weak self-esteem. What they envy in you is something they can never have, and that is the ability to function from within. In other words, they want your peace of mind, the ability to be with yourself by yourself, and just be happy, to experience joy, gratitude, and love. If they can't assimilate those characteristics from being with you, well, they'll just make sure you don't have them either. Drawn to you because of envy, incorporating what they believe is rightfully theirs, and when that doesn't satisfy them, and it never will, like a spoiled, greedy monster of a child, they have to destroy what they could never have, only to move on to the next shiny, new toy and the cycle begins again, and inevitably ends the same. Finally, for those of you out there who think the narcissist got away with something, I would rethink that one. This is who they are. And the cycle really never ends until they're stopped somehow, by someone. Even then, they're still them, and have to live this internal hell. You got away. Now who's the lucky one? Well, that's it for this week, and if you found this content helpful, please give a thumbs up, subscribe, and comment. You can find me on Facebook at NarcissistFreeAlmost, and on Instagram at Clumber_Lover. As always, all my love and gratitude, and I do hope you're living peace of mind narcissist free. I know, I am.